thermal imaging specification, sensor resolution, sensor pixel pitch. Do you really understand this stuff? Honestly, when I started, I did not. And I see a lot of people getting really confused comparing models and brands and not making a lot of sense of what the difference actually is. In this episode, we will go through the basics of thermal imaging and I will explain which technical data is important for you when you look into buying a thermal imager. So stay tuned. First thing we need to clarify probably is the difference between a thermal imager and a classic night vision. A classic night vision is pretty much a light amplifier, which means you need to have light to start with. This can be ambient low light from, for example, the moon, or infrared light coming from an external lamp. The reflection of that light is then enhanced in the night vision to give you a decent picture. Thermal imaging, however, does not need any light at all, but detects heat signatures coming directly from the object, not reflected. The difference of these two technologies is quite visible. Spotting animals at 600 to 800 meters is not a problem for a thermal imager. On classic night vision, however, think of pointing a flashlight at a 600 meter target. How much will you see? Remember, night vision depends on reflected light, so it really depends on how strong your IR lamp is. Since thermal imagers actually can detect infrared, you will also be able to see objects like the moon, clouds, and other objects that usually would be cold, but you're not seeing a heat signature, you're actually seeing an IR reflection. In situations where you have mist or smoke, you will see another big difference. Think of driving your car in deep mist and you turn on the extra headlights. What happens? You see nothing, you see even less because of the reflection from the fog. So the same happens to classic night vision. Since you are emitting from a light source and depending on reflection, all you will get back is the reflection from the fog or mist. Thermal imaging, however, has a much better way of penetrating the mist since the heat signature comes through the mist or fog towards you. You will get much better results looking through a thermal imager than you will through night vision. And that's also why, for example, the fire departments are using thermal imaging for fire detections. Rain, on the other hand, will have a negative impact on picture quality. It has a tendency to make the picture more grainy, although it's still a very good quality. Rain and humidity have also another negative impact, and that is that they seem to equalize the temperature in the surrounding. So, and since thermal imaging is very much depending on difference in temperature between objects, the background can fade a little bit into each other. But be sure, an animal will always stick out. If you're looking for a thermal imager for your gun, zeroing is definitely a topic you should be aware of. Since we're talking about thermal imaging, you will need to have a target that has a temperature difference. The easiest way is take a styrofoam block, put a heat pad from your gloves inside, make a little hole, and you'll have a perfect target. But, however, on automatic shooting ranges, this might not be possible to do, so please be aware of that. Fun fact though, when I had no heat pack available and I was in the middle of the forest and found out like, oh no, I forgot it at home. So what did I do? I took silver tape, taped it to the styrofoam and rubbed it with my thumb and then ran away to my shooting position 40 meters away to do the control shot. And the heat from my rubbing with the thumb actually was holding for 30 seconds. This is how good thermal imagers are in detecting temperature differences. Last but not least, Hollywood is fooling you. You cannot use a thermal imager to look through walls, and you cannot even use a thermal imager to look through glass. This you need a special surface treatment for. So when you're out with your car spotting animals, make sure to pull the windows down, otherwise you will not see anything. Before we go into technical specifications, look at videos and pictures, there's one thing that you need to know. What you see in the films and pictures is not what you see in the device. What you see in the device is actually way, way better. This came as a surprise to me, but I'll explain to you why this is so. See this little stickman I made? This is approximately the sensor size image of a 384x288 sensor. This is what you would see here in the sensor. So if we now shrink this down to 1.5x1.5cm image, which is here, right in front of your eyes, then you will see something very different. The image, shrinking down, will get sharper. If you now take this picture and you blow it up to the full screen size of your computer, you still only have 110,000 pixel points that you can share. And that is when the picture gets blurry. The same happens when you take a picture from the film, from the camera, from the small sensor, and put it on your big computer screen. You will get a blurry picture. And this is also what you will see in the example videos. And that's nothing strange. But remember, the original video that you see right in front of your eye is way, way better. Okay, let's look at the most important technical specifications. Display resolution. Like I said before, display resolution is really an important part because it impacts greatly the quality of the video that you see right in front of your eye. If you have a low sensor, the display can just do so much for you. It's like, think of those times when you bought this 4K TV and you put on an old film. Well, the film looks way better than it does on your old TV, but the 4K TV will only perform at its best when you put on a 4K film. So display resolution cannot make up for a bad or low resolution sensor. This brings us to the next point, sensor resolution. Like I said before, a display cannot show what the sensor is not delivering. So if you're having a low quality or small sensor, a display cannot make up for this. The sensor does, however, also impact something else, and that is the quality and size of the video that is saved. So if you're having a good sensor, like a 640x480 sensor, this is what you will be able to enjoy on your TV screen or on your computer. However, if you have a smaller sensor, like a 384x288, this is the maximum size that you will see. And then you will get into this stretching problem, as I explained earlier. Another point that the sensor size is impacting is field of view. Here I made an example video with the 640x480 sensor, and then, as a comparison, 384x288. Both filmed at the same time, at the same distance, towards the same object. You will clearly see by the red line where the picture size of the 384x288 lies. As you can see, the bigger sensor has a wider field of view. Last but not least, maybe the weirdest and least self-explanatory of them all, pixel pitch. What does that mean? Until lately, most devices on the market were running a pixel pitch of 17 micrometer, but recently even devices with 12 micrometers have been released. But what does that mean? Okay, let me explain it to you. Have a look at this picture. On this side, you see an old sensor, 17 micrometers. You see there's 4x4, quite sturdy pixels, evenly distributed. Now, on the other side, we see the new 12 micrometer pixel. You see, the pixels are much smaller, the distance between the pixels is much smaller, and you have a very high amount of pixels in the same line and in the same column. So pretty much in the same size, you can put more pixels. And pixels means more graphical points that are available to show in the display. This is why 12 micrometer devices are often way smaller than 17 micrometer devices. Here you have a 384x288 sensor with a 17 micrometer. And here you have a 384 times 288 with a 12 micrometer sensor. You see the difference? It's really huge. Now, what does this mean practically? Practically, this means that you will get a more softer, well-rounded picture right in front of you. But this only works at close ranges. The longer you get away from the target, the less impact this nice rounding has. Because remember, the picture gets smaller and smaller, and thereby the rounding doesn't have the same effect anymore. I have made a video here where you can see three different cameras, a 640 x 488 with a 17 micrometer pixel pitch, a classic 384 x 288 with 17 micrometer pixel pitch, and a new 384 x 288 with a 12 micrometer pixel pitch. What you can see is that between the two old sensors with a 17 micrometer, you can clearly see the difference. And this 640 x 480 is really a way more expensive sensor model than this one in the middle. But when you look at the 17 micrometer, on a close distance, they are almost equal in the quality of the picture. And you can only see in the far distance where the 640 x 480 is sticking out. Do you see how smooth the borders are in the 12 micrometer sensor? It's almost equal to the higher 640 480 sensor with a 17 micrometer pixel pitch. But, and that is why I ran the comparison at a distance, the further away you get from the target, the lesser the impact of the pixel pitch gets. This nice smooth rounding of the edges, it has not the same impact on a 100 meter target as it has on a 50 meter target. If you're usually hunting over a feeder at distances of 50 to 60 meters, then a smaller sensor with a smaller pixel pitch might be perfect and more cost effective for you. If you're on the other hand hunting over wide fields and scanning 400 to 800 meters for wild boar, and you need to know if that's a wild boar or if it's just another roe deer that you're sneaking up on, then I would definitely go for sensor size instead of pixel pitch. A combination of both is of course great, but for long distances, sensor size beats pixel pitch. This is it. I hope you enjoyed the video. If so, leave a thumbs up. I hope this really gives you some help to find through the technical specification jungle and that you find the thermal imager that is suitable for your type of hunting. If you haven't done so, subscribe. And leave a comment if I have forgotten anything. Until then, Weidmannsheil and Huitjagd.